for all of his wonderful blessings. Thank you for being here today as we come to celebrate our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because I want to tell you, he is alive and well. Amen. And is he alive and well? Hallelujah. And we want to give God praise for loving us. Thank him for his blessings this morning. Thank him that we can trust the Lord together. And we just want to give God praise for all that God is doing in our lives and our hearts. And I want to thank him for being so good to us. Has God been good to you? Amen. It's so good this morning to be able to trust in the Lord. And we just want to thank him and praise him for all of his wonderful blessings in our life. Thank you for being here today. If you're attending with us today for the first time, we want you to make you welcome here at Poovey's Chapel as we come together to worship and just praise God together. And whatever you need today, I promise you God is able. Amen. How many of you believe God is able? And let's trust him for great things in our life. Thank him for what he did for us last year, this past year. All the people got saved. Hallelujah. What a blessing. Amen. If you got saved last year, would you just stand up? If you got saved in the past year, would you stand up? Hallelujah. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. What a blessing. Praise the Lord. Thank you. You can be seated. I want to tell you, God is able. Amen. So guess what? Everybody you've been praying for, everybody you've been thinking about that needs Jesus, get them here. They need him. Amen. And let's trust the Lord to save them, work in their lives. And we just praise God for what he's doing and give him thanksgiving. I have just a couple announcements this morning real quick. There won't be any children's church today. And then this will be our only service today. We just come together to celebrate this new year. And then beginning Wednesday night this week, we'll be back on our regular schedule. I know they were calling for some snow and stuff for next Sunday. So we're praying that'll be gone until Sunday night. Amen. So you pray for that. But any weather-related schedule change we have will be on Channel 3, Channel 9, Facebook, and every other way that we can get it out there. So please remember that while we go through these winter months. And also just remember all the great things that God has planned for us here at Poovey's Chapel. A lot of things listed there in your bulletin. I want to tell you about a men's Saturday. It's going to be on January the 21st. We have a men's meeting here. It's going to be start at 7 o'clock from 7 to 9. Going to have breakfast and then service here from 9 to 12 in the sanctuary. So please remember that. And a lot of great things listed there in your bulletin. So please take time to look at all of those. And we just want to praise God for what he's doing in our hearts and lives together and give him thanksgiving. And if you are attending with us today for the first time, we have a very special gift for you right after service. So if you'll go right to our welcome center out in the foyer, we have a special gift and want to thank you so much for being here. And also, I'll ask our ushers to come forward as we get ready to forgive our tithes and offerings and give you time to get your hand in your pocketbook or out of your billfold out. Well, that wasn't even funny, was it? Amen. I have an announcement I'd like to read. Donald Lynn Jenkins and Pamela Lynn Williams, together with their families, invite you to share in the joy of their marriage on Saturday, January the 14th, 2017, at 2 o'clock here at Poovey's Chapel Baptist Church, with a reception to follow. And if you are planning to attend their wedding, they have a sign-up sheet at the Welcome Center, so please take time to fill that out so they can prepare for you to be here. Also, I have a card I'd like to read. Thanks so much for the beautiful dish garden for my brother Ralph's funeral. Please continue to pray for my family. Love, and this is from Helen and Sonny Anderson and the Stewart family. So please continue to pray for them, that God will just bless them and lift them up in a special way. And God will just meet their needs. And I'm glad today that we can trust the Lord to meet our needs. Amen. And give God thanksgiving for all that God is doing. I do know we have some people that sent some message this morning that they are sick. So I know there's sickness going around and all these things. So let's remember that in prayer and just continue to pray for them. Lord, lift them up. Continue to pray for these that had surgery this week. Lord, just lift them up. Johnny Shell had surgery. Continue to pray for him. And also Kara Van Dyke, pray for her. She had surgery this week also and recovering from surgery. So please remember her in prayer. Also be in prayer for Rhonda Smith. She has been in the hospital since Christmas Day at Catawba Hospital. So please remember her, that Lord just lift her up. She's been in liver failure. So pray for her, that God will just encourage her. They moved her to room 433 yesterday. So please remember her in prayer and all the family. God will just lift them up and meet their needs. And then we want to continue to pray for little Madison Connor's family. Little Madison is a little girl, 13 years old, here in our community. She's been here several times back in the back. She's always in a stroller. She passed away on Saturday. So please remember that family in prayer, that God would lift them up. Kathy and Roger White that attend here, remember them. That is their grandchild. And that funeral is going to be tomorrow at 2 o'clock at Greer Funeral Home. So please remember that family in prayer, that God would just surround them during this time and give them comfort and peace. I want to promise you something. One day we're going to a place, if you're saved, there'll be no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more death. Amen. What a day that is going to be. We want to give God praise this morning and give God thanksgiving for all that God is doing. As I said, I know there's a lot of sickness. I know Willie Story, his kids, pray for them. They're sick, so pray that God will lift both of them up. Lord, just touch them and others that are sick. Donna Thomas, and so we've got a list. So pray for them. Lord, just lift them up and meet their needs today. How many of you today, you got a special need in your life? Amen. I want to promise you something, what the Lord said. He said, for whatsoever things you shall ask in prayer, believing, what's going to happen? You shall receive. How many of you want to receive it today? Amen? Let's trust the Lord together. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll ask our ushers to lead us at this time as we pray together.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
To be back in your
God,
house,
you are
Lord.
So good, Jesus.
Thank you for
God, thank
year,
you,
God,
Father,
you
for being so good to us.
To
God.
Be here
thank
on
you,
earth, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Part of your plan, Father.
Yes, Lord.
I
thank you, Jesus.
Year, Lord. I thank
God,
for
we give you honor.
Up,
we give
God,
you glory.
Like
hallelujah.
God, we give you
yes.
praise for that,
thank
Lord.
You, Jesus. God, for loving us, Lord. Thank you for the peace.
Continue to bless this church, Lord.
Oh, God, I pray you bless
the ones that come in, Lord, that's lost. God, that just fill your power and your spirit.
Yes, Lord. God, encourage them,
God, see their need for a
Lord, I pray, God, you touch these ears here, Lord. Encourage them. Lift them up, Father.
Let us
pray for Madison.
God, I pray for this
Lord, you just
offering,
touch
God,
them and put your hand upon them, God.
Glory.
Give them strength and
God,
encouragement right now, Lord.
Lord,
God, just lift them
just
up,
lift
Jesus.
Him up, encourage
yes,
speak
Father.
To him today, God.
Hallelujah, Lord. I know you've got a plan,
God,
a purpose,
hear,
Lord.
God,
thank you for all these that have given their life to you this year. Hallelujah, Jesus. God, we give you praise, honor, and glory. Lord, you are so good.
Thank you,
Lord.
God, everything that you do for us, God, we pray, God, you just bless
yes, Jesus.
All these that are sick, God, and you just encourage the ones, Lord, that lost a family member, Lord, this little girl
oh, God,
that passed away. Lord,
Jesus,
you just surround them with your peace, God.
God,
your
encourage them, Lord.
God,
lift them
up,
Jesus.
We just give you praise, God, that you can take care of every need, Lord. We
oh,
just
yes.
want to tell you we love you
Father,
today
I pray
and just thank you for
done,
everything
God.
You do. For it's in Jesus' holy and precious
Hallelujah.
Name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm glad this morning God is in control. He knows everything that we need. We want to praise Him for it. Any of our children that has the offering for Lottie Moon, as we continue to do that, you can put it right here in the globe while the offering's being passed today. And just give God praise for what God is doing, allowing us to be part of lives all around the world through our missions. And we want to give Him glory and honor. Amen. And at this time, let's worship with the choir as they sing. And let's just praise Him. Amen. God has been good to us. God is good. And God is going to be good. Amen. And let's worship and praise Him. Hallelujah.
Each day that I live, He gives more than I need. I could never describe His goodness to me. You ask how I make take it day after day. There's only one thing I can say. I'm hungry, he feeds me with manna so sweet. When my soul is weary, he gives peace and rest. All I can say is I'm blessed. Now I've had my share of sunshine and rain, and days filled with laughter and my nights filled with pain. But with every mile as I travel his way, the journey gets sweeter each day.
Thank you. God, what a name. Amen. I bless His good name. Thank God for the name of Jesus. Jesus said if we'd lift His name up, lift Him up, it'd draw all manner of men to Him. I bless His good name. Thank God for the hope that we have in Jesus. And praise God, He's a coming back. You got something, sister? Amen. Hallelujah. It's just good to get in. Amen. Hey, I bless His good name. If you don't know Him, it is our prayer, hey, that you come to know the name of Jesus. Amen. And it's more than a name. Praise God, He's a person. Amen. He's Lord and Savior. I bless His name. You worship. Hey, let's continue to worship as the choir comes down, fellowship one with another. And again, no children's church today. Everybody's going to stay in. So you pray for the service and ask God's will to be done. God bless you. Amen. God is so good. We bless His name. Amen. Thank God for His grace and His mercy this morning. You can be seated. Thank you so much for being in the house of the Lord. We give God praise for His blessings today. Hallelujah. Just bless His name. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you blessed today? Just like the song said, we're so blessed, and we want to give God thanksgiving for His blessings. Thank Him for the opportunity God has given us again this morning on this side of eternity to meet together, to worship Him, and to praise Him. And I'm going to ask Hope
and Brooke Dula, they're going to come and get ready. And while they are, I'm going to ask Brother Chris Worley to come. He's got something on his heart he wants to share this morning. And we just want to thank God for being so good to us and the opportunities the Lord gives us to share and worship together. And give God praise. Hallelujah. Give Him thanksgiving. Amen.
I don't want to take very much time, but the Lord laid this on my heart, and I can't help but share it. Dad passed away December the 7th this past month, if you didn't know. And sometimes when things happen to you, you think, well, Lord, that's the only, it only happens to me, right? I'm the only person with a flat tire, the only person that's late. When it happens to you, you're the only one. But God's Word says that there's people in a lot worse shape. And I just wanted to, as a personal card, we did order some thank you cards, so I do have them, and I'll get them to the church as soon as I can. But I just want to personally thank the church, and Mary Coffey, if you're here, is Mary here? Those guys that take care of the family and the food, what a blessing they are. And I tell you, she's just like a ninja, because we were at the service, and then I come home, and then there's the food. So what a blessing that is. I mean, people don't know what a blessing that is. But God's Word says this in the book of Matthew. It says, chapter number 28, verse 16, then the 11 disciples went away to Galilee unto a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Isn't that like us? Boy, I doubt. I know I do. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. That's good enough for me. And so as we think about this past year and the things that you might have went through, all power is given to him, not on this earth, but in heaven. So I just want to tell you, church, thank you. Thank you, Pastor.
What do you say to someone who feels like they've lost it all? Over the edge with no one there to break their fall. What do you say to someone who feels so unloved? Giving themselves away a little bit every day just to be good enough. And what do you say to a hopeless soul who can't remember their way home? And everything is out of their control. There is no valley. There is no darkness, there is no sorrow greater than the grace of Jesus. There is no moment, there is no distance, there is no heartbreak He can't take you through. So before you think that you're too lost to say,
hallelujah. I'm glad there's nothing greater than grace. Amen. No sin, no shame, nothing that we ever face in life is greater than grace. Amen. And thank God for the grace of God and what God has done in our lives. And we just want to bless His name this morning and give God thanksgiving. God is good. Amen. Thank God for His wonderful Word. I'm glad that God gives us the opportunity this morning to look in the Word of God, and we come together, trust in Him, and just ask the Lord to speak to us. I want you to take your Bibles this morning, if you will, and turn to the book of 1 Samuel in the Old Testament, the book of 1 Samuel, and then we're going to turn to chapter number 17, 1 Samuel chapter number 17 this morning as we look in the Word of God at one of the greatest stories that God has given us in the Word as we read about someone that faced something that was greater than them. And I want to tell you today, none of us know what we are facing in the days to come. Amen. Look at somebody and say, that's right. We don't have a clue what we're facing. Some of us face things in the year past that we had no idea that we would ever go through or struggle through or walk through or be joyous through. We experienced things great and things that were awful and things that were semi-good. We face things in life. We lived life. And I want to tell you, that is what we're about right here. We live a real life. Amen? But there's real love, and thank God there's a real Savior. Hallelujah. As we look at the Word of God this morning and think about valleys that we go through. Have you ever been through a valley? Now think about valleys that we go through. All of us will face valleys in our life. Someone that said, and I've heard it said a lot over the years, we are either in a valley, going into a valley, or coming out of a valley. There's those valley experiences that we have, and when I say valley, that means being at the bottom, being at the place where we don't see any light, and we don't see how we're going to get out from where we are. We don't see things changing around us. It's in that place of a valley in our life. And so those valleys, mountaintop experiences, and valleys are very much a part of our lives. Now think about valleys. There's a lot that happens in valleys today. Some of us may be in deep valleys that we feel that we can't even see light where we are. That we can't see the way out or the way up or the way through those things that are on us. Matter of fact, it's in a place. You ever felt like that place where you just needed to catch a little bit of a break? That place where everything that's going on in your life seems to get worse. You get over this one thing and then there's something else. Have you ever been there before? You been there? All right. You really been there? Raise your hand if you've been there. Praise the Lord, so we can see we all people. Amen. Look at somebody and say, you just a people. We just people. Amen. That's in need of a Savior. We're in need of help where we are. We are. We see others that seemingly go through life and are unaffected, but continue to search for that sunshine in the valley. We continue to look for a way out. We continue to look for what can help us where we are. Matter of fact, sometimes we don't realize it in the valley, but the valley can be the most fruitful place that has ever been. As a matter of fact, in the valley is the place where a lot of times we grow more than we ever do on the mountaintops. In the valley is a place where sometimes as we go through, we wonder, God, how long am I going to stay here? But it's the place where God is building us and leading us and filling us to prepare us for the climb that is ahead. Or it sets our life in motion to the place of enjoying the victory that comes as we come upon the mountaintop of life. Matter of fact, I want to tell you this morning, as we look at these few scriptures over this month, our in that place of life where our valleys are, even in the valley, by the way, I want to remind you, even in the valley, God is good. Amen. Now think about our valleys. Our valleys can be victorious. This morning, we're going to look in 1 Samuel chapter number 17. It's a place where an army was in a valley. When I think about this whole army being in the valley and this whole nation, if you will, being in a valley, I understand something about valleys. Sometimes it's a place that there's a battle in the valley. Now, I want to tell you, sometimes when you're in the valley, it's the hardest place to stay faithful. Would you agree? In the valley, sometimes it's the hardest place to make decisions. In the valley, sometimes it's the hardest place to see further than where you are standing at that very second. As we look at 1 Samuel chapter number 17, we understand that even in the valley, there's going to be battles that take place. Matter of fact, these battles that happen sometimes in the valley are battles of darkness. This valley, it is a battle, as the Bible describes it over in Ephesians chapter number 6. It is a spiritual warfare that comes against your life to keep us from being where we need to be. And Israel is experiencing that battlefield. They are experiencing that battle in the valley. I want you to look with me. We're going to look at two verses of Scripture, and then we're going to look at this chapter. Look in verse number 3. It's 1 Samuel 17 and verse number 3. The Word of God says, "And the Philistines stood on a mountain on the one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side. And there was a," what? "Valley that is between them." Then I want you to look with me, if you will, to verse number 19. "Now Saul and they and all the men of Israel." How many? All the men of Israel. I want to tell you something. When Israel was going through something, not only were all the men in the valley or in the battle that is going through it, but all of them, because they are going together as one. They are going through what they are going through. It's going to affect the whole entire nation. Can I just remind you about something today? You are not by yourself. Everything you are going through is affecting someone else. Amen? And so we understand they are all going through where they are. They were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines. There's a valley going on, and there is a battle in this valley. I want to give us a few things that happens in a valley. And first of all, number one, there's fear that happens. Look in verse number 32 with me. Verse number 32 lets us know about some fear that is taking place. "And David said to Saul, 'Let no man's heart fail because of him.'" David said, you got to understand something about, I really started to title this, "The Pizza Boy is coming to deliver them from the giant." Because guess what David brought? David's just come down to the battlefield for a little bit. Matter of fact, he's a young man that has come. He has sent, all of his brothers were old enough to go out into war, but David is not. And so his dad says, "David, I want you to get this bread. I want you to take this cheese." That's what you do with pizza, right? Bread, cheese on top. How you put? Hey, he said, "I want you to take this down to the battlefield. I want you to check on your brothers, see how they're doing." So all David is doing, he's just a delivery guy. His car is still running with a little pyramid thing on top of it that says pizza delivery. He's not even there to camp out. He's not there to stay. He's just passing through where he is. And so as he is there, he understands something that is upon these men. He understands something as a young man that has happened to the children of Israel. And they have been locked up in fear. They are afraid. I want to tell you something, friend. Fear will keep us from stepping where we need to step. Fear will keep us from doing what we need to do. Fear of the enemy will keep us from being who God has saved us to be. Amen? They were afraid of something. Number one, they were afraid of the size of the battle. I want you to look back with me, if you will, in these verses of Scripture. Look back to verse number 4 right quick. The Bible lets us know something. We understand. Get this in your mind for just a second. There's a valley. There's the Philistines on one side, Israel on the other side. And in the middle of that valley would come out this champion every single day and challenge Israel. Here's what it says. The Bible says in verse number 4, "And there went out a champion out of the camp of the Philistines named," what's his name? "Goliath of Gath, whose height was six cubits and a span." That's about 9 feet, 6 inches tall. He is a trained warrior. He is a killing machine. He has one thing on his mind, and that is to kill as many Israelites as he can kill. He's not looking to pat them on the back. He's not looking for a championship trophy from them. He is looking to take their lives. I want to remind you about something in 2017. That is exactly what the enemy wants to do to you and I.
He wants to take us down. He wants to take our life. He don't want to just pat you on the back. The enemy don't just want you to have a good time for a few minutes. The enemy wants to take you completely down and destroy you. Oh, as you look at this enemy, he is huge. He had a helmet, the Bible says there in verse number 5, of brass upon his head. He has an arm that he is armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of his coat was 5,000 shillings of brass. And he had graves of brass upon his legs and a target of brass upon his shoulders. And the staff of spear was like a weaver's beam. And his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron. And one bearing a shield went before him. Oh, and you look at what he's doing in verse number 8, how the Bible said, and he stood and cried unto the armies of Israel and said unto them, why are you come out to your battle in array? He said, am not I a Philistine, and ye servants of Saul? Choose you a man for you and let him come down to me. You know what they were afraid? The size of the enemy. When I look at this battle and I look where they are, the fear in the valley because of the greatness of the enemy. Some of you this morning, some of us as we are sitting here, we're thinking about the enemies that is around us and the greatness, the grip that the enemy has upon us. And I want to tell you something this morning, there's no power greater than our God. Amen. Oh, and I think about this enemy. The enemy is a giant. And there is no one in the armies of Israel, not even Saul himself, is equipped to face this giant. Matter of fact, no one has challenged him because he's enormous. No one has looked upon him and said, we're going to take you down, because they understood if they went and they failed, then what is going to happen? Have you ever thought before, I would do that, but I am afraid that I can't make it. I would do that, but I'm afraid that I cannot carry it out. I've heard people say, give this excuse, by the way. This is not real. They give an excuse that Satan has given them, put in their pocket, so they can carry it around. They say, well, I get saved, but I just can't live a Christian life. Can I just tell you something? Bah, humbug on that. Amen. Listen, I want to tell you, none of us can. Don't let fear keep you from stepping over. Well, I would sing that song, but I'm just afraid that I can't sing it. I'm afraid to see people close their eyes and sing, glory to God. Amen. 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 That fear. Don't let fear keep us from being who God has said we should be. Here's what it says in the book of Proverbs, chapter number 22 and verse number 13, in case you need some scripture for that fear. He said, the slothful man saith, there is a lion without, and I shall be slain in the streets. So does that mean fear makes us lazy? Whoop, come on now. Does that mean that fear in our life keeps us from being the one that God, understand that God has strength? Here's what it says, the slothful man. That means the lazy, that means those that don't care, that means those that have quit, that means those that like their recliner better than they like work. Right. Y'all know what I mean, don't you? Yes, sir. I don't have to keep on explaining that, do I? Is that pretty clear? If it is, say, yeah, it's clear.
Yeah, pretty clear.
He said, you know what? They won't even go out in the streets. So I said, there's a line out there. Can I ask you a question this morning? This is going to be pretty common sense. Did anybody, when you walked out your door this morning, see a line in your street? If you did, would you raise your hand? Okay, just making sure. You know what? We get afraid of things that ain't even there.
Amen.
Y'all ever been there before? Man, I remember growing up as a young kid. I mean, you would think, wow, you would think there'd be boogers in the closet. Y'all know what I mean? Monsters under the bed. I had an older sister. They might have been. Amen. I don't know. When I think about living life, sometimes we live in fear of nothing that is there. But that's not this fear. They could see the size of this enemy. They could understand that this enemy was greater than them. They could understand that there's going to be a destruction upon them. Matter of fact, I want to remind you about something. Y'all ready? I'm going to give you a revelation for 2017. The enemy is greater than you. The enemy is impossible. The enemy that we are facing in our life cannot be handled by us. Israel sitting back. There's no handling this enemy. I'm going to give you this. I'm not going to read all these scriptures from verse number 9 all the way down through verse number 11. How we understand something about this enemy. He will come out every single day. I can see. Can y'all not see him marching out? I wish that somebody. Where's Lucas at? Lucas, you here? Lucas is almost 9 foot. Amen. Could y'all imagine? I mean, every single day this guy comes out marching down this valley. I mean, can you imagine after the first day he marches down there and nobody comes? The second day he's like, yeah, just bring it on. Y'all know what I mean, don't you? I mean, he is marching down knowing that he can take anybody anywhere and nobody's going to come. Matter of fact, he gets so much and so involved in where he is, they begin to understand why he's there. It's not to destroy the armies of Israel. It is to defy the God of Israel. You see, they understood something that we don't understand a lot of times. They understood that the Philistines, they served gods, and what they were empowered by their gods. And he said, Israel, is your God not big enough to bring you down here and face this giant? I want to ask you something today. What the giant is saying in your life, is it keeping you from being who you need to be? Is it bigger than your God? Is it bigger than who God is in your life? There is fear that is keeping them. Oh, it's the saying of the enemy. He kept saying, hey, y'all, come on down here. I'm going to take care of you. Send somebody down. Whenever you come down, here's what we're going to do. We're going to have a battle, and this battle is going to be it. Can I just tell you something today? I want to remind you about something. The enemy does not have the rules to the battle. Can I remind you about that? The enemy don't have the rules to the battle. Listen, God has already set the rules. The enemy couldn't even go in Job's house until God opened the door for him. Woo! Amen. Hey, I want to tell you, listen, don't let Satan give you things that is not there. Here's what happens. The enemy, he comes. Here's the saying of the enemy. He said, I'm going to tell you something. He said, I'm going to let you know something. He said, I'm coming in to where you are. Oh, listen, the enemy has challenged their faith, and he's challenged their faithfulness. Y'all believe in God. You keep saying you believe in God. Where are you? You know what's happened in our world today? They've challenged our faith, and we have sit back in the church and closed the door. Hey, 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 the world don't even know there's real faith. Amen? Oh, he said, look, here's that saying of the enemy. God, here he is. He is defying their God. The enemy in the battle always attacks our faith. He will bring doubt, and he will bring dismay, which results in fear. Some of you right here, listen, you need Jesus in your life. You know you do. God's speaking to you, and he's saying, hey, you need to trust me. You need to be saved. You need your life to change. And you're going, yeah, but what will so-and-so say? Man, Satan just jumps up there and says, yeah, but I tell you what, if you get saved, you can't drink anymore. You can't smoke anymore. You can't cuss anymore. I mean, I could go down a whole list. It'd be all right, wouldn't it? I mean, you could just list it all. I know some of y'all, that was a shocking revelation. You didn't think you could do that stuff. You thought you could still do all that stuff. Amen. You think about life itself. The enemy says, oh, I want to cause doubt upon who you are, who your God is, so that you have fear in your life and not trust what Jesus can do in your life. Amen. Yes, sir. That fear that comes. Oh, and I think about that fear. I think about what the Bible says in 1 Peter 5 and verse number 8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. I can see that big Philistine walking back and forth down in that valley. Can y'all see him? I mean, he's just pacing back and forth, saying, where are y'all? Like a roaring lion. He is coming out every day. Where are you? Where's your God? What is going to happen? I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. You come down here and you are going to serve us. Oh, when you look at this Philistine, can I just remind you about something? The enemy will destroy our hope with his words. The enemy will destroy your hope with his words. That's exactly what he did to Adam and Eve. And he's been doing it ever since. Matter of fact, I want to give you this real fast about fear. Y'all ready? Can y'all listen fast? The cause You got to understand something about Israel. They seen the cause. They understood what the giant was saying. They understood what the Philistines were about. They understood that there's a cause that they got to get to battle and they've got to fix this. You know what they're doing? They're sitting up there wringing their hands saying, how are we going to fix this? And they just keep saying, how are we going to fix this? What are we going to do about this? How are we going to change this? The enemy's down here marching in the battle. He is. Are we just going to stay here and sit on this hill and just let him keep marching? What are we going to do? They've seen the cause. Can I just tell you something? Just knowing the cause won't change you. They understood the cause. They understood there's something they need to do. They understood that they got to be motivated. Can I just tell you something? When fear captivates you, you cannot motivate yourself enough to do something about it. The fear is this. Oh, the cause that they had. The cause did not motivate them. The need did not push them forward. But fear froze them. Fear had them frozen right where they were. I want to give you the second thing, and that is this. There's also the fight. Look in verse number 32 with me. I love verse number 32. I can see little old David. He said, let no man's heart fail him. He said, don't let him be afraid. He said, listen, because of him, thy servant will go and fight this Philistine. Amen. Can you imagine little David? I look at little David, and I think about David as being, I think about him being a sawmill. Putting a log on it and just tearing that thing plumb up. Amen? I mean, you think about David. He said, look, he said, this, what is that giant? He said, don't let nobody be afraid of him. I'll go fight him. Yeah. Can I ask you a question? This ain't even in no notes, nowhere else. Where'd your fight go? Amen. You know what happens? Can I just tell y'all where your fight went, where it goes a lot of times? We start fighting amongst each other and start bickering against each other instead of bickering against the world. Whoop, whoop. Thought I'd just throw that in. Amen. You say, what's going on? I don't know. It's a brand new year. I ain't even ever heard nothing. Amen. Can I just tell you what will happen? Satan will try to get you against one another rather than for the cause and in the real fight. And that real fight was that there's a whole nation that is hanging on a thread by one man in the valley, by the enemy that is there. And David said, I'll take the enemy. Just let me have him. Could you imagine little old David? David's not a mean-spirited person. We know David. Man, we've already seen David. He's played a harp. Bling, before Saul. He's been Saul's armor bearer. Man, he's carried Saul's armor for him. We understand something about David. David's got a gentle spirit. So David's not mean. He just knows whenever there's something needs to be done, he just needs to do it. Amen? You watch old David. He's got some fight in him. I want to give you something about David. There was no fear. How did David not have fear? There is grown men, army-trained men. They know everything there is to know. I mean, if you pull out Discipleship 101, they can tell you everything about the Bible. They can tell you everything about missions. They can tell you everything about the church. They can tell you everything, but they're sitting on the hillside and not doing nothing about the enemy. David said, let's go! We can pronounce it. We can say it. We can do it. We've got all this stuff. Let's go do what we know we need to be doing. Amen. And so David, he has no fear. He said, thy servant will go and fight. Can you imagine Saul's false teeth when David said that? Had to fall from a head higher than everybody else. His mouth flies open. There's a little bit of, are you kidding me, in Saul? The big king, Saul, who's been walking around saying, boys, somebody's got to go get this man. Y'all know them kind of people, don't you? We got them. Y'all, somebody needs to do something about this. Did you know you the person to do something about it? Rewind that. You the person to do something about it. Listen, I want to tell you, when you think about where Saul is and what is going on, this fight. I love what he said in 2 Timothy 1 and verse number 5, verse number 7. He said, for God hath not given us a spirit of fear. So if you got it, you didn't get it from God. He said, God didn't give us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. David stepped forward as the most unqualified one there. David stepped forward and said, I'll go and fight. He's the most unqualified. But he was the most anointed. Can I remind you about something? You don't have to know how. You just got to know him. You say, oh, I don't know how I can handle where I am. Listen, you don't have to worry about the how. Just get in with him and let him do the how. Amen? God will take care of where you are. Oh, and I think about David. His fear disappeared in faith. His fear just gone in faith. How could David have this much faith? He's young. And what in the world could David do at this point? Matter of fact, the fight in him is for the cause before him. God gave David something that the others have missed out on. Matter of fact, when you come over to 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse number 12, he says, fight the good fight, lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. I want to ask you something today. Have you ever let anybody know you saved? Does people know you saved? You know what they're looking for? They're looking for you to be different. I'm not talking about different. I'm talking about they're looking for you to walk different.
Yes, sir.
They're looking for you to talk different.
Amen.
They are looking for you to have faith different.
Yes.
Where is that faith? Oh, David, he said, look, he said, here, let's go. Have fight that is there. Here's what Saul said. Look in verse number 33. I'm not going to read the whole verse. Verse number 33. The Bible said, and Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him. David said, I'll go. Saul said, you ain't able to go. Wow. There was no fear. Then you look, he said, you're not able. Can I just let you know something? Friend, I want to tell you what. Don't let Satan tell you you're not able to do what God's already put in your heart you need to do. He said, you're not able. Saul is the commander of the army. Saul is the king of Israel. On Saul's word, he could say, David, if you go down there, I am going to take your life. He said, you're not able. He said, there's nothing in you that says that you are able to do what you feel like you are supposed to be doing. By the way, can I just tell you something? It is not David's ability that he's going on. It's his anointing. Can I remind you about something? So many times we try to go on our ability and we fail. You got to go on your anointing. See, what's happening is all the men of Israel and all the children of Israel and all the armies of Israel, they're trying to go on their ability. Can you hear them in the tent at night? Man, you sure? I think if we go down through there and I hit that guy in the left side of his right knee, I can take him down. I took you down like that, didn't I? they're trying to find out how they can do this. Some of you right here, you're trying to figure out how you can do this. You're not able. David, it wasn't David's ability, it was his anointing. Can I just tell you something today? God's got an anointing that we need. Amen? That anointing. Now look what David said. I want you to look at it with me real quick. Verse number 34 all the way down through verse number 37. I'm not going to take time to read all these. Here's what David said. He said, I want to let you know why I can go fight, because he never fails. David said, I want to tell you what, there's fight in me because I'm serving one that never fails. And I love what David said. Here's David. Can y'all look at David for just a minute? David is standing before King Saul. And he said, I ain't afraid, I'll go fight. King Saul says, you ain't able to go. David said, yeah, but here's my resume.
Yeah.
He said, I was out keeping the sheep, he said, and I just want to tell you something. He said, there's a lion and a bear come out and got a sheep and took off with it. He said, I killed them both. He's waiting on the decision of Saul, by the way. He said, yeah. He said, Saul said, what? He said, your car's still running. Your sign's still on out on your car. You just a delivery boy. He said, no. He said, I want to tell you what happened to me. He said, I smote a lion and a bear. Can I just drop a little nugget down on you? He killed them both at the same time. I've always read this story, and I've always thought, okay, he killed a lion one day. Man, he drug that lion home. Can you imagine him going home with that big old fur? Daddy, look what I brought home today. He said, he killed a bear. Can you imagine the next day going home? We got a new rug for the house, Daddy. Y'all can see it, can't you? What would y'all do with it? Oh, David said, if you read the scripture, and I'll be honest, I read this and I thought, Lord, what'd you say? Thought, did that say what I thought it said? Looks like God have said to me. I read it again. I started reading after other people, see if they thought the same thing and said that. I want to tell you what, he said, I killed a lion and a bear at the same time. He said, he got it and stuck the sheep in his mouth. I got the sheep out of his mouth. He said, while I was taking care of him, a lion grabbed it and took off with it. I got him by the beard and threw him down and took the sheep out of his mouth. Ba-ha-ha. Amen. Oh, can you imagine? Can you imagine as he is standing before old King Saul and he said, I want to let you know something. It's not me, but my God never fails. He said, so I can fight because I have God, and He will never, ever, 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 never fail me. Oh, wow. When you look at Him, oh, I love what He said. Here's what He said. I can imagine that big old lion's head up on David's bedroom wall. The big bear right beside of it. David lay down every night and say, yeah, hallelujah. Because there's a plaque under that says, my God delivers. Because here's what he said in verse number 37. He said, I'll let you know something. God delivered me then, and God can deliver me now. Hey, 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 hallelujah. And I'll just tell you something. There's victory in the valley. By them old boys, they've been sitting up there long enough that they needed some cheese and bread. They've been sitting up there long enough they've run out of food. They've been sitting up there long enough they don't know what else to do. And here comes little old David just marching in and say, I'll tell you what, we can just go down there and kick him. We'll take care of that old Goliath. We can do it. Let's go and let's fight it. Let's go and step forward in it. I love what he says in Zechariah 4 and verse number 6. Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Can I remind you about something today? It ain't you, but it's him in you. Oh, let him be victorious in your valley. There's going to be battles. There's going to be troubles. There's going to be times we have no idea what to do. And God will send some little old David hopping by our way just to say, come on, let's go get it. Hey, I want to tell you what, he can turn your valley into a place of victory. Oh, as you look at what happened in the rest of this story, as you understand something, there's a fit that happens. We just had a fit with this computer. Y'all do know, every single time at this time, every Sunday, this thing goes out, don't you? I want to tell you what it says. It says there was a fit that happened. From verse number 38 on down, you understand something that happens in his life. From verse 38 to verse number 40, oh, Saul, here's what Saul said. I love what Saul did. Because he couldn't refute what David said. David said, God will deliver me. Saul said, okay, we're just going to trust. So you see Saul, he says, hey, boys, how about bring my armor over here? Saul comes over. As he comes over, he comes over to David. And he said, here, David, here's my armor. And he got all that coat of armor, and he puts it on little old David. And while he's got David, he's, can y'all see David standing there? I mean, he's got on a 3X, and he wears a youth small. And David is standing there like, he can't even move. He puts all his armor on. He said, if you're going to go out, here's what you're going to go out for. He said, man, you got to be protected. He said, I just want to tell you, David. He said, if you're going to go do this, I've been out in battle before. Saul wasn't lying. Saul was doing what was best, he thought, for David. He said, David, you got to do this. You got to be protected. You got to put on what you have. He said, there's a fit you got to have. There's a fit for you. Can I just tell you something about this fit? Number one, it was flesh. It was all Saul knew how to do. He was putting every effort into the life of David. The armor of the flesh, by the way, will not work in the battle of the spiritual. There's a lot of people that say we are Christians and we're trying to make it through and you just keep battling. Can I just tell you something? You need to let go and say, Jesus, here I am. I need you to save me. And from the, you can't live a Christian life without Jesus. Amen. I've been in church all of my life. I was 17 years old whenever I got saved. Listen, I want to tell you something. You cannot live a Christian. You can't be a Christian without Jesus living in you. You can push through. You can try to make it look pretty. You can sing songs. You can pray. You can do all these things. But unless Jesus is living in you, you ain't got what you need. Amen? That arm of the flesh. Saul said, put this on. Put on this religion. It'll make you look good. Just turn over this new leaf. We got a brand new year. It's 2017. Just get everything in line. And we're going to make it look. We're going to change our life. Do you know how many people last night threw out all their Breyers ice cream? Because they're going to change life today. They done at the grocery store, son. They run outside and it was already melted and they done buying them some more. Amen. Can I tell you what? Those suits that we put on, that place of trying to make things happen and work in our life, it ain't going to work. It just covers up what we are. Saul said, put this on. I love what David did. You find David, you understand that David had a faith shield. David said, Saul. Matter of fact, David was always respectful to Saul. He was always respectful to him, even when he was trying to take his life. It was a faith shield. David could only use what he had already proven. David said, I've already been through this, Saul. I fought a lion and a bear at the same time. I rescued a sheep. He said, I believe this is going to be all right. He said, I believe things are going to take place here, Saul. He said, I tell you what. He said, I'm just going to use what I've always used. I'm going to use what's worked. Can I just tell you something? If what you have does not include the Word of God, does not include time with God, does not include the worship of God, it ain't going to work. Amen? And when you look at what is going on, there is that fight. There is that fit that is taking place. There's that faith shield. I want to tell you what he had. This thing's not working, brother. I want to tell you what he had. Bible says he goes down to the creek and gets 5 smooth stones. And I just realized I forgot my David slingshot. I had one laying on my Bible. I forgot it. Well, somebody run home and get that for me. No, I'm just kidding. He had his little slingshot. He had his little pouch on the side where he put his stones in. Said he got 5 smooth stones. He had 5 stones. He had 1 sling. And he had a big God. He knew what he needed. He knew what could change him. He knew what could help him. He knew what he needed for the battle. When I look at David, I want to say something real quick. Can I? That'd be all right with y'all? I know there's all kind of things. 5 is the number of grace. 5 is the number of death in the Bible. But Goliath was one of 5 giants. So I really believe when David went out, he wasn't just going for one. He was going for all of them. And I want to jump way over in this story and tell you at the end of David's life, he killed the other 4. That's right. He didn't quit. Can I just tell you, there's going to be giants popping up in your life. Get the stones you need out of the Word of God. It's the rock. It's the shield. It'll give you what you need. It was fit. That fit was not the flesh. It was a shield of faith. Then they went forward. The Bible says in verse number 40, down through verse number 48, here's what happens. The Bible says the battle commences. There's the battle in the valley. It took David forward in his faith. You know what faith will do? Faith will move you forward. Faith don't just sit still. Faith just don't say I'm saved and quit. Faith just don't say I'm praying for lost people and never try to reach lost people. Faith just don't say, hey, I need to give. I want to give and never give. Faith just don't sit still. Faith does what faith does, and that is to move forward in who God has called you to be. And that's exactly what happened in David's life. He gets his stones. He gets his little slingshot. And he takes off. And the Bible says he marches forward toward this giant. There's 2 things that happen in this forward march. There's the scene. Here's what was seen. Goliath coming down. He sees the dirt stirring over there on the other side. He sees a little dust coming off the hill. He said, maybe somebody is coming down this way. Maybe, what is taking place here? I see a little dirt coming up. And so old Goliath says, it's time to go. So guess what he does? Here's the scene. Goliath comes marching down. But Goliath is not by himself. The Bible says he is somebody that is carrying his shield. So as David goes down, he's not just facing one. He's facing how many? One plus one is three. Somebody said one plus one is two. They can tell they've been out of school for 2 weeks. He's marching toward two. Little old David. I'll be really honest with you. I don't even think David even looked at there's two of them. David's looking at old Goliath. And he probably can't see Goliath because God's in front of him. And all he sees is the glory. Amen. David marching forward. There's the scene. Can I just tell you something about the enemy? Y'all want to know something about the enemy? He always displays. Satan always has to be seen. Satan always has to show himself. Satan always comes with others. There's demon influences. Whenever I watch and see this, then I see as he goes forward, there's the unseen. Old David's coming down the hill by himself. Can I just tell you something? Old Saul and them children, them other men of Israel, you know what they're up there doing? Building a casket. They don't think it's possible. Think, man, how in the world are we going to tell Jesse? You can see all them guys, they're all on Facebook. Man, I can't believe what's getting ready to happen. They was just doing it in stone. You watch them. Man, there goes David. But I'll tell you what, the unseen is the greatest scene. Oh, David, as he marches forward, and as you and I march forward in our battle, I want to tell you what happened. David ran to the battle. David did not cower back in the corner and say, oh, I hope he don't come get me. David stepped forward and ran to the giant. And I want to tell you something. Faith will take you from the frozen fear to going forward to face that giant. I'll tell you what happens. He was fearless. Look in verse number 49 with me in closing. The Bible says in verse number 49, and David put his hand in his bag, took thence a stone, slang it. Don't you like that? And smote the Philistine in his forehead, that the stone sunk into his forehead, and he fell upon his face to the earth. Wow. I can't really imagine in my mind. I can read it and I can try to put pictures together in my head of what it looks like. I do believe in heaven, everything is DVR'd. We're going to get to see it again, amen? But I can't imagine, oh David, can you imagine David running, taking that sling, and the giants are running toward him with his big sword and he's got the shield dude in front of him? David slings that one stone. Can I tell you what? When they did that, when they would sling that stone, pew, he was reaching in his bag for another one. Can I just tell you something about life? You can't just quit because there's a giant. You understand, there's got to be fearlessness whenever you are in the valley. The enemy fell. And the rest of these verses of Scripture, all the way down through verse number 54, you find an enormous God. David, he goes and he stands upon old Goliath. Can you imagine? Old David, he wasn't puffed up. Old David said, I ain't even got a sword. Take care of him. Oh, he's got a sword. David picks that sword up. takes the head off that old Philistine. That was a sign of conquering. That was a sign of victory. That was a sign of overcoming. I want to tell you what happened. All those men of Israel that had been sitting back with their bows and arrows, with their rocks, with every weapon they had, laid back in their tent. Man, they turned around, get in the tent, get everything they got, take off toward those Philistines. Put the Philistines in flight. Can I tell you what that one giant that's standing in front of you and you have absolutely no idea how to handle? You, if you are born again, if you know Jesus, you have an enormous God. Amen. And He is able to take care of that giant in such a way that those that's been wondering about you, they can understand that, yes, we can go. Yes, there's victory. Yes, God can. And I want to tell you what God did. God prevailed through the hand of David. And God gave victory to all of Israel. What do you want God to do in your valley? It's real easy for us just to hang out in our valley. Because sometimes in the valley we find some good fruit. You've been in the Jordan Valley? Oh, I'm going to tell you, you get down there. Ooh. I mean, these grapes, they might not be that big, but they look that big. There's good stuff in the valley. Sometimes we just want to hang out in the valley and graze because we feel like we can't go any further. And we got giants that we face and we say, nah, I'll just hang out where I am. You know something? God's got something greater than you can ever even imagine. You know what it takes? You and I understanding God is able in me to do the impossible. Amen. They were facing the impossible and they came out victorious. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word and your witness in our lives. Thank you for speaking to us today, God. Lord, I just want to praise you that you know every single thing about us. You know where we are. You know what is going on. And God, you know how, Lord, that we need you more than anything else in life. And right now, God, as we are here this morning, God, there's some in the valley. Some going into a valley. Maybe some just on the edge of coming out of a valley. Help us not to hear Satan. Help us not to take his words and cause that victory to be gone and that valley to be the place where we stay because of the words that Satan puts in us that give us the fear. But Lord, help us to be, understand that fight, that we step forward in who you are. God, and allow you to work in us. Heads bowed and eyes closed for just a minute. You say, Pastor, this morning, I'm in that valley. I need to come. Listen, while these are coming, don't wait. Just let God. God knows where you're at already. Let's get up and trust Him. It's 2007, brand new year. God, I want to trust you where I am. Listen, some of you, right now, you're going through a valley in your life with your children. They're lost. They ain't been in church. Listen, you've lost your burden for them. You just need to come and say, God, Lord, this year, God, I want the victory over them. I want you to, God, I want you to speak to them. Some of you's got things you've been praying for and praying about. We do. Listen, you get so discouraged sometimes, you don't see things happen. Be a time to say, God, that giant's bigger than me. God, where I am is bigger than me. God, what I'm facing is bigger than me. But God, you're able. You're able, God. And right now, I give it to you, God. I want to come by faith. I want to, hey, you know what David did? He stepped toward where he was. He stepped toward that giant. He stepped toward the things that were happening in his life. He said, God, here I am, Lord. I'm coming toward it. God, hey, I want to tell you, if you never go toward it, you'll never, ever battle it. If you don't go toward that giant and say, God, here I am, you will never, ever, ever get past that place. God, I don't know how to handle it, Lord. Here I am, though. God, give me my little old stones. Give me a sling, God, because I got a big God, and I'm coming. Lord, I'm coming. I'm coming toward it, God. I'm coming toward what you have for me, God. I want it. Some of you right now, listen, you've been wanting a relationship with Jesus. God's speaking to you. Listen, He keeps dealing with you. He keeps telling you that you need to be saved, that you're lost, you'll die and go to hell without Him. You know that. You understand that you're a sinner, that you sinned against God, as He said, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You understand right now, listen, that you need Jesus. Hey, I want to tell you, today's your day. Get up and go to Him. Lord, here I am. God, I want to come. I want to know you. We'll take God's word and show you how simple it is to trust Jesus as Savior and Lord. He said, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. He said, look, you believe that Jesus died and rose again. He said, you shall be saved. You can trust Him. This morning, I want to tell you, your life can be changed forever. Glory to God. Listen, right now, how much victory do you want? How much do you want right now? Listen, would you come? Will you let God just speak to you? Listen, I know right now you got burdens on your heart. You got things you're facing in life that's greater than you. Listen, let God. Just let God right now. Let God speak to you. Let God deal with you. Let God open your heart. Lord, here I am. Right now, I want you to do me a favor right now. I want you to pray for the person in the pew right beside of you. Say, God, speak to them. Lord, you know what they need. You know the valley they're in. God, you know what they're going through. And I want to pray for them right now that you would just speak to them, Lord, and help them to come to that place of trusting Christ. Listen, trusting Him with their problem, trusting Him with the need, trusting Him with the valley, trusting Him for salvation, whatever it is. God, I want to trust You. I look to You. I lean on You. Friend, God knows where you are today. Your valley can be victorious. You can have a victorious valley. That place of understanding of victory. Listen, it wasn't just victory for David. It was victory for all of Israel. Do you know today what God wants to do in your life can only change you, but your whole family? It can change your workplace. It can change your community, what God wants to do in your life. Listen, don't underscore God and say, God, you can't do this. God's bigger than the giant. God's bigger than where you are. There's always going to be a battle in the valley. Let God work in your life. You say this morning, preacher, listen, right now, I'm not ready to meet Jesus. If I died right now, I'm really not saved. I don't know the Lord in my life. Pray for me. I am concerned about my own life. Pray for me. Would you just slip your hand up? Just slip it. I'm really not sure I'm saved. Pray for me. I don't have that peace in my heart that I know Jesus. I'm still not sure I'm saved. Hey, friend, I want to tell you, He loves you. Glory to God. He wants you to know Him. Listen, you can come this morning. You can come. He wants to save you. You say this morning, preacher, in my life right now, I know I'm saved, but I've walked away from God. There's things in my life, sin in my life, things that should not be in my life. Pray for me. Would you just slip your hand up? I know I need the touch from God. I need Him to forgive me. I need God to help me. I need God to help me in my life right now. God bless your hearts. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being honest with God. Listen, you know where you are. You know what's in your life. You know the giants around you. I need some help. Maybe you're facing some things. I need some help from God for my giants in my life. Would you slip your hand up? I got some things going on in my life. I need God to help me with. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being honest with God. Boy, I'm glad He knows us. Hallelujah. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you for being honest with God. Hey, He knows us. He knows us. Hallelujah. Somebody right now, you know, they're in a valley. It might be somebody that's lost and they're wandering in a valley with chains on them that Satan's dragging them to hell. And their sin is dragging them to hell. You say this morning, while I'm sitting here, God is speaking to me about that person. Pray for that person. Would you just slip your hand up? I got somebody in my life that God has put on my heart while we're in this service. Somebody today, you say, you know something? God's put somebody on my heart that's in a valley today. Help me pray for them. Would you just slip your hand up? I know where they are, and I want to pray for them. Hallelujah. Well, I'm glad He's able. Glory to God. Father, we love You today. Thank You, God, for being so good to us. Thank You for Your love in our life. Thank You for the power of the Word of God. Lord, I'm glad Your Word is a lamp and a light. God, I'm glad that through Your Word we have life. Lord, I praise You for the Word today, God. Thank You for loving us. Thank You for the presence of God in this place. Lord, thank You for Your Word that You have revealed to us this morning. God, I thank You that in the valley there can be victory because You are there, God. Hallelujah. Father, I pray You would speak to us. God, You work in our lives. Help us to hear You. Help us to be obedient to You. Help us, Lord, to receive whatever You're speaking to us about in faith. And God, I pray for these today, Lord, that are lost, that we see Satan is dragging them to the valley. Oh, God, I pray in the name of Jesus, You break the bands around them. Surround them in Holy Ghost conviction, God. Lord, I pray with these right now, God, that's facing giants and demons and sin in their life, Lord. Things around us, oh God, that we need deliverance from. Lord, we pray for Your deliverance. God, we pray for those right now we know that's going through valleys. Help us to reach them. Help us, God, to be an encouragement to them. Help us to be with them. God, I pray, Lord, that You would just save them in this valley. God, give them strength and grace. We love You. We praise You. Thank You for the victory You give us, God. And we give You glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you glad today there's victory?